So today we have Dimitris Pierrakos from Athena Research Center from Greece, that is the service manager of the OpenAIRE UsageCounts service, that I would like to thank their availability to be here today to present the service. So Dimitris, the floor is
Thanks,
yours.
Andre. Okay, let me share my screen. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes, it's working.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So I can start. Good morning. Thanks, Andrea, for the introduction. And I'd like to thank you all for joining this series of OpenAIRE webinars and this UsageCounts webinars in particular. A few more details about me. I have a bachelor in physics and an MSc and a PhD in computer science. And since 2014, I work in OpenAIRE project as a member of the technical team. And as Andrea mentioned, I'm the developer and the administrator or product manager of the OpenAIRE UsageCounts service. The UsageCounts service is the service developed in OpenAIRE in order to analyze the usage activity in content providers participating in OpenAIRE and build usage statistics. Usage statistics provide a kind of alternative way to measure the impact of the research and complement traditional scholarly impact indicators. But I will dive into more details during this presentation. So, an overview of this presentation. First, we will present a short introduction to the concept of usage statistics, why they are important, as well as what are the available standards for acquiring and exchanging the usage statistics. Then we will present the UsageCounts service operation in terms of architecture and engagement with the service, some initial numbers that show how the service has been deployed. An interesting part of, at least for me, for this presentation, and I hope for you also, will be the future developments. We'll discuss the and present the updates in the use of statistics concepts after the employment of some kind of form of a new standard. And finally, we will proceed with a demo, I hope without surprises, that we will try to show how the service outcomes have been deployed and how they could be consumed by various interfaces, either inside OpenAIRE or from content providers in particular. So, first of all, user statistics. What are user statistics and why do we bother collecting, building and working with them? Usage statistics are based on the processing of usage events. And usage events are triggered by accessing the digital objects in content providers, for example, repositories, journals, and CRIS systems. So digital objects are articles, data sets, theses, books, et cetera. And once triggered, a usage event could be either a metadata view of the digital object, for example, a visit of the metadata page of an article, or a full text download. Usage statistics, why are we using them? Why are we exploiting them? Usage statistics are important not only to content providers, but also to a variety of stakeholders like publishers, aggregators, or funders. For many content providers, usage statistics are a required element of their regular and typical reporting to funding and accreditation agencies. Usage statistics can play an important role in driving a bibliographic institution, internal marketing, and the development of the provider's website. For example, for publishers, the number of full text requests for a given journal is a strong indicator of the impact of the journal. In terms of marketing, monitoring usage over time is a good way of determining the effectiveness of various content and marketing or campaigning strategies that may be implemented. Finally, aggregators like publishers with larger services, they require user statistics. They want user statistics not only to assist with collection management, but also to help with the overall management of their services. For example, again, monitoring full text retrieval over time helps with capacity planning for their infrastructures and allow the services to plan ahead for growth or even peaks of their services. So more or less, user statistics is a logical choice as another impact measure that could supplement other impact factors like the citation counts. Don't forget that digital readership information can be easily and somehow routinely collected. So another aspect is that bibliometric indicators do not show the usage of public published work by non-authors, for example, students, academics, or non-academic users who do not usually publish but may read scholarly publications. So usage-based statistics for academic publications may therefore give help to give a better understanding of the usage patterns of documents and can be most recent than other bibliometric indicators. And this is a very important aspect of the usage statistics as a concept. So on the data provider level, user statistics can serve repository managers or content or hosting institution as a tool to evaluate the success of their publication platform. On the individual item level, on the other hand, they can demonstrate, this tool can demonstrate popular publications to authors and readers. So in addition to other traditional measures like citation counts or alternative metrics, for example, mentions, recommendations, posts in social media, it can inform funding authorities in research evaluation processes. Finally, user statistics on the item level can reflect the relevance of a particular research output of research topics of data sources over the course of time and up to the present. So they can be an important indicator to analyze the trends for these items. So we discussed the importance of user statistics, but how about standards? Is there a way to have a common language to collect, exchange, and most importantly, compare user statistics among content providers? And here where the counter code of practice enters the scene. Counter, which stands for Counting Online Usage of Network Electronic Resources, is a non-profit organization which is supported by a global community of library, publisher, and vendor members. And all this contributes to the development of a set of directives that consist the Counter Code of Practice through working groups and outreach. So Counter Code of Practice is some more or less the international standard used by librarians, publishers, and other content providers for reporting usage events for electronic resources in a standardized ways. And I will add also for collecting and processing the usage events. So it's not only for publishing, but also for counter code of practice provides the instructions, the directive for processing also the usage events that are collected. So counter standardized usage reports allow providers to compare usage across different publisher platforms, assess user activity, inform renewal and new purchasing decisions, justify budget spends to the stakeholders, derive cost per use for content, and inform faculty power users about or power users about the value and use of current content provider or library resources. There is a variety of services offering usage statistics. IRUS, of course, is the national service for the UK. Make that account that focuses on datasets, knowledge and labs, Elsevier for publishers, La Referencia that covers the South America, Operas that mostly focuses on books and monographs, RAMB and PLOS. So, how about our service, the Usage Count service? This is the usage statistics service for OpenAIRE Research Graph, and I explain this concept in the next slides. First of all, OpenAIRE. OpenAIRE is a European project funded by the European Commission since 2008, and has led the shift to open scholarship in Europe and help alignment with the rest of the world. So OpenAIRE more or less bridges the worlds where science occurs and science is published. In one hand, OpenAIRE is a community-driven organization at heart, which accomplishes a participatory infrastructure in European Union member states and associated countries. And this is an infrastructure is accompanied by a service-driven approach, which aims to support, accelerate, and monitor open science. So OpenAIRE offers services for any kind of, for all stakeholders, researchers, scientists, content providers, funders, institutions, etc. So one of these services, the Usage Count service, that we will be discussed in this presentation. The main structure of OpenAIRE information is the OpenAIRE research graph, comprised of interlinked scientific products with access rights information linked to funding information and research communities. OpenAIRE graph provides a kind of a model for the representation of information, and OpenAIRE uses it to represent objects, which are in the context of OpenAIRE are called research products. And these research products are presented in the scholarly communication domain, and they also includes the relationships that exist among them. So the UsageCounts service inside OpenAIRE infrastructure, UsageCounts service is one of the pillar services of OpenAIRE, and simply counts the usage of the graph entities. In other words, the usage of the research products across the network of OpenAIRE content providers. So in one hand, we have the content providers that produce the content, like institutional repositories, aggregators, data archives, software repositories. This content is enhanced by other functionalities of OpenAIRE, which operate on research products, for example, the duplication or mining. And then the UsageCount service exploits all this enhanced information to provide a more holistic approach to usage statistics. And this will be discussed later. So how we do it and how the service operates? We have two different approaches for building usage statistics. The first approach is based on the push or what we call a push workflow, which is depicted in the upper part of the graph. And this approach is based on the Matomo Analytics platform. Following this approach, an institutional repository registered in OpenAIRE Providers Portal, which is the main entry for participating in the OpenAIRE infrastructure. So after the registration, a server-side tracking software is offered for this for the content provider in the form of either a plugin for this space platform or patches for the ePrints platform. We are also offering a generic Matomo or a generic tracker software, which is based on Matomo that covers all the other platforms that are available. So all the plugins and patches and the generic Matomo tracker are exploiting the Matomo HTTP API. I'd like to mention that we do not use Matomo's native tracker, which is based on JavaScript, in order to avoid what we call missing indirect requests. So we don't want to miss indirect requests. For example, if a request for a PDF in a content provider is coming via Google Scholar, Matomo native's JavaScript tracker will not count it, while our server-side software will properly recognize the request and track it accordingly. So usage activities tracked and logged at Matomo platform in real time. IP anonymization is also offered as an option in order to respect users' privacy. So keep in mind that IP anonymization is offered again at the server side. So if it is enabled, all IPs are transferred anonymized to Matomo. We do not have the IPs anonymized inside Matomo, but they are arrived anonymized if this option is enabled. Also, counter code of practice robust list is also used in when we are processing the usage row activity in order to remove non-legitimate traffic. So information is transferred offline to OpenAIRE's databases for statistical analysis that follows again the counter code of practice directives. And from this user statistics database, statistics are deployed in OpenAIRE's portal like Provide, Explore, and recently the Open Science Monitor, or can be collected by API endpoints, which are based on SushiLite protocol. So this is the first approach. The second approach, we call it, follows a pull form of a workflow. This is used for gathering of consolidated statistics reports from aggregation services. This is the case that we have employed for AIRE UK. And we are using protocols that are based on SushiLite or other REST API interfaces. We are also covering, using this pull workflow, we are also covering open science journals using a dedicated plugin for OJS platforms. Again, statistics are stored to OpenAIRE's database for statistical analysis. They are integrated with statistics count collected from the other from the push workflow, and then again are deployed by OpenAIRE's interfaces, portals, or can be retrieved by the SushiLite API. So just to recap, the main services for our for UsageCount, we are tracking of usage row activity using the push workflow, or we are collecting counter reports following the pull workflow. We are offering anonymization of IPs. We are enhanced this usage information with metadata duplication, which enables accumulation of usage for the same search outputs. This is the role of the metadata index that I mentioned in the previous slides. Usage statistics are produced and are created using the counter code of practice in order to provide standard-based form of usage statistics. And we are finally, as mentioned in previous slides, we are producing indicators that complement other traditional and alternative bibliometric indicators in order to provide a comprehensive and most important, a recent view of the impact of the academic resources. Usage counts is also a part of EOSC. All these features that are provided by usage counts are also available in EOSC, where usage counts is a core service offering the account, what is known the task of accounting for research products. So a research products account service is able to aggregate either by push or pull usage indicators for different type of EOSC research products like data sets, articles, books, et cetera. And research products accounting is provided by the OpenAIRE usage account service. As a part of EOSC, usage statistics will be collected and made available. Research product usage statistics are integrated with EOSC research product catalog. And another important aspect is that enrichment of EOSC resource catalog with usage statistics indicator will be visible to end users and offered in the dump of the catalog when published in Zenodo. So together with all the metadata information, the EOSC resource catalog which will be published in Zenodo, will also include the usage statistics that have been produced by our service. And usage counts is also a part of the virtual access metrics accounting system offered by EOSC. So engagement. How can you participate in the service? First, you have to visit the provider's dashboard. And you have to register your data source, if either you are a literature repository, a data repository, a journal, or aggregator. The next step is you have the option to enable the metrics, the usage statistics for selected data sort. There are four different steps that need to be performed, three on our side, on the participant sides, and one in our side. On your side, you have to download the tracking code for your repository platform, either the pads, either for the space, for the prints, or if you have another platform, you could download the generic tracker. You have to configure it according to the instructions that are provided in the documentation, or you can contact us for support. And finally, you have to deploy the tracking code in your repository platform. On our side, in OpenAIRE side, we are as soon as the repository enables the service, we are starting monitoring in the repository in Matoma. I will show you in demo later how this is realized. So we are continuously monitoring the service, and when everything is okay, the usage events that are coming to our platform, and we are validating the installation of the tracking code and inform the repository manager accordingly if everything is okay according to the recommendations. So for the software, the next step is to configure the metrics. You have to download the patches for various versions of the space. We are now supporting the space 4, 5, and 6, and soon we will support the space 7. We are offering an ePrints plugin for version 3. And again, as mentioned, we have a Python script for all the other cases. So it's the configuration of the service is very easily, it can be easily done, and you have the full support of us if it required. This is how row usage events are collected in real time. This is where Matomo is actually employed. This is a view only for UsageCounts service administrator, and we use it initially to validate the content provider and then to monitor the provider usage activity. As mentioned in the description of the push workflow, we are transferring this raw usage activity. We are processing it using the counter code of practice directives, and then we build and store the user statistics in OpenAIRE statistics database. From there, they are deployed to portals or retrieved by API endpoints. But we are continuously monitoring the service. We do not use Matomo for statistics, but only for monitoring. So let's see some service number. We have collected information from more than 200 content providers. The majority of them are institutional repositories. We have also covering journals. We have 20 journals. We have data repositories, publication repository aggregators, and we have the scholarly communication infrastructure, which is the OpenAIRE portal itself. We are also collecting information from OpenAIRE portal. We have already collected up till May 2022, 6 million research products. We have collected usage statistics for 6 million research products. We have 247 million views and 732 million downloads. And of course, the number of downloads is greater due to the indirect requests that are covered, that are collected by our tracking software. By the end of this week, we will update the statistics up to June 2022. So you can also see the evolution for the last year of the number of views and downloads that we are collecting. And you can see that we are collecting for more than 10 million views and 20 million downloads. As I mentioned, it's until May 2022. Finally, we are offering a counter code of practice release for reports, which are supported. We are supporting five reports that you can use to retrieve counter code of practice compliant reports. We are. I will show you a demo later in the of this kind of reports and what you can actually get from by using these reports. So this is the current status of the service, and I'd like to move to the future and the future developments and the upcoming updates that will be I think that will be of great importance for content providers that participate or want to participate in the service. So the upcoming updates, the implementation of counter code of practice new release, the release 5. So all the concepts that we have discussed so far are following the counter code of practice release 4. Views, downloads, counter code of practice, reports, etc. The new release somehow changes completely the way that usage events are collected, counted, and published. So I will try to explain what are the new metrics and the reports for this new release of counter. I will provide some examples and also a comparison between the release 4, which is currently offered, and the upcoming release 5. I will also try to discuss the new concepts that are introduced, like data types, access methods, etc. So first of all, metric types. We have to forget the traditional views and downloads and move to the new concepts of the new terms of release 5, investigation and request. So in release 5, every usage event is considered an investigation. So investigation instruct when a user performs any action in relation to a content item or a title. Either it's a metadata view, abstract view, an HTML full text, a PDF full text, a download PDF, or an article preview. On the other hand, a request is specifically related to viewing or download the full content item. It's more or less close to the concept of downloads in the release 4 version of the counter code of practice. So new metrics are also using the suffix unique and total to further categorize the metric types. So you have the unique item investigations, which count the unique article investigations and requests inside the user session. The total item investigations, which count the total number of times information is related to an article viewed, including all article full content views. The unique item request, which count unique article full content views in a given session, regardless of its format. So for example, if a user views an article PDF and HTML in the same session, this would only count as one. And the total item request, which counts all article full content views across all formats, like HTML and PDF. This is more or less equivalent to release four downloads counts as mentioned in the previous slide. I will try to provide in a scenario. Susan, we have a user named Susan, which is researching the history of Porto inside Umino repository. And from a list of search results, she opens three article abstracts. So the counts for the according to the code of practice list five is three total item investigations and three unique item investigations. So after reading these abstracts, Susan downloads the PDFs for two of these articles. The counts change to five for total item investigations, since we have three views and two downloads. Three stays for unique item investigations, but now we have two total item requests and two unique item requests. And this is, I'm leaving this this example in this slide, so you, for further references, you can see the changes and how this counter code of practice list five operates. So if we want to compare release four and five, release five metrics, we could notice that downloads and total item requests are the same, are almost the same as you could see in the graph, while views and total item investigations are completely different metrics. So views and total item investigations cannot compare to views. So why do we use them? Why do we have this release, these changes in this release? So the counter code of practice list five metric type features. The total item requests are important for providers that more or less have full text content and they report the number of full text downloads or views. The total item investigation provides a big picture perspective of the total number of investigations, and unique investigation requests are considered powerful metrics for identifying activities within unique items and titles, and they are considered most accurate for cost per use analysis. Having discussed the new metrics, let's move on to the other concepts which are introduced in release five. Data type, it's a pretty self-explanatory. It identifies a general type of content being accessed or for which usage is being reported or built or calculated. For example, data type could be an article, a book, a segment, a collection, database, dataset, etc. Release five also introduces the access type concept, which describes the nature of access control that was in place when the content item was accessed, and the attribute appeared in journal title report one. This is a form of a counter list five report, and allows usage of open access content to be separated from content that requires a license. So we have control, open access delayed, open access gold, APC, etc. The access method is an attribute indicating whether the usage related to investigation requests was generated either by a human, which browses the repository or the library or whatever, or whatever the content provider form is, or by text and data mining processes. And this attribute appears as an optional parameter, and TDM usage is excluded from the standard journal and book reports. These are some details for the publication, for the production of the reports. Finally, release five also introduced the concept of the year of publication, which is the year of publication for the content item accessed. So if content is available in print and online format and the publication dates of these two formats differ, the year of publication of the print will be used. And this attribute appear in journal title report as well as book reports. So in terms of reports, release five has a reduced number of reports. We have four master reports, 16 total versus the 24 reports that we have in the counter release four. Many of the special purpose reports that are seldom used are replaced with a small number of flexible generic reports, and all counter release four reports have either been renamed or eliminated in order to use the new version, the new releases report options. We have more filters to select dates, content types, metric types, year of publication, license types, and more in various combinations. This is the list of counter release 5 reports, the platform master reports, the platform usage, etc. In the context of OpenAIRE, this is our initial implementation of the release 5 reports. We have developed 2 master reports for platform and items, the platform master report, which is a report summarizing usage activity for the repository by month, metric type, and item type, and the platform usage and the institutional report, the platform master item report, which is a report for items requested by month, metric type, item type, and repository. And we also developed the platform usage report, which is a report summarizing usage activity for a repository by month, broken down by metric type. We have also added a dataset report, which is not included officially and has been introduced by Make Data Count initiative for reporting user statistics for dataset explicitly. The report also uses the new metrics that have been introduced in the release 5, in particular investigation requests. But as I mentioned, it's not included officially, for at least for this current release, in the counter code of practice directive. So as an example, the filters that are allowed, if we want to get a platform master report, the difference is that we are now the release 4 reports. There are no filters in the, if you have used already the release 4 reports, you can see that you will remember that there are no filters for the metric type, which are now offered in the platform master reports. And I'm talking about the total item request or total investigation that could be selected. And this is an example of a platform master report following the counter code of practice, list 5. And for the platform like the University of Minho. And you can see the data type, the access method, the total item investigations and the request, etc. And finally, this is the release 5 report attributes that could be used in order to generate the reports. Some of the yellow are the most important, which can be used and will be offered in our reports. So before proceeding with a recap, I would like to show you a demo. Can you see my screen again?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You are seeing Matomo.
Okay. So, this is the main Matomo platform that we used for monitoring in real time the repositories. So, for example, if I select the Umino and change okay so for today okay we can have the events for in real time. You can see here that we have a metadata view for this particular item, the title of the item, and also a download. So this is as I mentioned, this is only used for monitoring purposes or the initial validation of the repository. So every time a repository or a content provider is registered in the service, we are using this interface to check if everything is recorded properly, and later on we will validate. We are validating the service. So you can see an overview of the reports. We can see this is the raw usage activity again, as I mentioned, it's in real time. The usagecounts.openair.eu is the main portal of the service, where you can see information for the service itself. You can see what is the usagecount service, why OpenAIRE usagecount service, what are the benefits for providers and consumers. We can have some features of the service. You can have some form of analytics. For example, you can see the worldwide results. We have more than 200 repositories. This is a number that has been more than that, of course. It's more than 200 repositories. The views are 248 and 732 million downloads. You can also search for a country. For example, if I choose Spain, you can see the number of the repositories for Spain. Okay, let's wait. Couple. Now, this is not normal. Okay. So we have the number of repositories is 16, and we have collected 45 million views from Spain and 14 million downloads for this particular country. You can also see the monthly events as arrived in Matomo. You can see the monthly views and downloads that I have already presented in the slides, and in the resources, you can get a usage counter release for report. For example, as I mentioned, we have the article report, the item report, the general repository, and the book report. I will give an example for this particular report. If I begin, if I enter the date for. Then I will check for the whole period, and I will check for an item using the DOI. I hope I found, yes, this is one I'm looking for. So if I click get report, you will see the report in JSON format for this particular item, and the number of requests for January 0. For February, we have 4 downloads and 1 view, etc. For March 3, 2, 0 for April, and 1 download for format. And this is a report that can be easily retrieved. So in provide, I mentioned this is the place where you register, but you can also see the usage events, the user statistics that we have collected in this for your repository. And I will try to log in. I would use the example of my favorite repository of Mino. Okay, and you can see the usage counts either in tabular form, either in boxes or in a form of visualization like this in the graph format, total views and downloads. From here, you can get the statistics reports, and we have the 5 reports that are compliant with the counter code of practice list 4. So if you check the article report and select, for example, for the first 5 months of 2022, you will get the reports. I hope there are no issues with our backend services. Okay, so these are the results for the first five months for the Mino repository. You can see for this particular article, you have the zero downloads and views for January, February, and we have in March, and we have only one download and one view during April. For this particular, we have more information. We have for this particular article, we have more information. For example, we have one downloaded, one view. This is in a tabular format, not in the JSON format that was displayed in the other interface. So we have two options. In provide, we are offering tabular format of this reports, whilst in the UsageCounts portal, we are offering the JSON formats if you want to retrieve them directly. Usage activity is also displayed in OpenAIRE Explore. I don't know if you are familiar with this. This is the main interface where you can find, we can search all content that is available in OpenAIRE Research Graph. Again, I will search for Mino University as a data source. Okay. And you can see on the left side that we have the total number of usage statistics that we have produced, that we have published. And if you click, you will have the total number of views and downloads for each month. Again, this is a similar with the one that you have seen in the provided dashboard. However, in OpenAIRE Explore, this is an interesting outcome. You can, if you set for this for a publication, for example, for this publication, you can see that this publication has 20 usage events counted for this particular item, either views and downloads. The important thing is that if I click on this button, you will see that we have 19 downloads and one total view. And these have been aggregated from different content providers. This is how we exploit the metadata index that are mentioned in our initial one of the first slides. So all this information for this particular item has been aggregated and presented in this form. So we can have, if you are an author of this particular item, if you are a publisher, you can see that for this in Explore, in a portal, you can see how this the total statistics for this particular item inside the OpenAIRE infrastructure. Finally, we've mentioned the reports. So the last interface is Monitor, which is a new portal that is offered for monitoring the research in institutions and funders. So Monitor offers dashboards for various types of organizations like funders, institutions, etc. So if I select an institution, which will be public, for example, we have that has public information, in particular University of Göttingen, I will move to its institutional dashboard. And here the user statistics are in the form of impact. So you can see that for this particular institution, we have 82,000 publications, and we have the average downloads per publication and the total downloads. You can see also a number of, let's say, interesting indicators that are based on user statistics that we have collected. For example, the downloads per publication over time, or downloads per publication over time based on the year of publication. the downloads per publication over time and by project participation with abstract over time. This is important because it shows the downloads of publication by open access route over time, if it's green, bronze, etc., or the by downloads per publication by open access route and the year of download. As you can see, there are a number of indicators that we have built, and the user statistics are one of the main parameters of this graphs that are used to somehow provide the impact of this to measure the impact of this institution. We also see the top journals and per publication from repositories. You can check this this interface, and you can examine it and see what will be offered in this from this form of impact, let's say, for this particular interface. So let me go back to my presentation. So for recap, OpenAIRE UsageCounts service is an easily configured robust service. These are the key messages that I would like to convey in this from this presentation. It follows counter code of practice standards, release 4 and release 5 in the future. And the UsageCounts service for provided is a form of an umbrella system similar to the EOS that provides information of on the impact of your repository by integrating usage data and offering comparable analytics of the repository's content across the OpenAIRE infrastructure. For research products, operates on OpenAIRE research graphs and allows aggregated user statistics of the research products from repositories all over the world. So you will gain the advantage of using aggregated user statistics of your research products. So that's all for me. Thank you very much for your attention and for your participation. I hope you have liked this presentation and found it useful. I would like to pass the floor to André in order to guide you through the feedback of this for this presentation using this Menti tool.
We also have some questions in the chat.
Okay.
Maybe we can start replying to some questions, and then we can move to the.
Let me stop sharing my screen, and I will try to find. Okay.
The first question is: it's about what represent the views and downloads, and why the views and downloads are different. And Carlo already answered about the difference between the numbers of views and downloads. But what are the difference between views and downloads?
So someone has replied. Sorry, I couldn't understand the question.
Yes, Carlo replied about why we have different numbers of views and downloads.
I mentioned in my presentation of the push workflow that the number of views are less than the number of downloads because we are offering what we call the indirect hits. We are counting indirect hits. So I also described an example. So assume that you have a repository, you have an article which has a full text in its landing page. So if I visit the repository and I click on this article and I click on the download of the PDF, I will have one view and one download. Is this correct? Okay. So, but if I search for this article in the Google Scholar and I receive a search results and I click on the search result and I will go directly to the repository for downloading the PDF document, this is counted as a download only, not as a metadata view. So that's why we have more views than downloads.
Okay. We have a question from Ellie asking if it is possible to show numbers for an aggregator, for example, Narcissus.
But more the question was, can you show it?
Because we are not aggregating from Narcissus, as far as I know.
Narcissus is it's a Dutch portal.
Yeah, yes, we are not aggregating from, we are not collecting usage events from Narcissus. If you want to join the service, of course, we can participate. I think we discussed it earlier, right?
But I've heard that it could be done, but I thought it, okay. So I have to ask if it can be done.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. From us, it's no problem. I mean, we can aggregate, we can receive usage events from aggregators, so you have to simply participate on the service.
Okay.
We have another question from Magdalena. Do you know how Matomo counts the views and downloads? Do they filter bots? Is the first question.
Yes. Okay, so if Matomo counts views and downloads, yes, it counts views and downloads. It can differentiate between views and downloads. But as I mentioned, we do not use Matomo for our service. We are simply collecting the events, and then we are processing to count views and downloads using the counter code of practice list of bots that is updated continuously. Matomo is more or less is used as a monitoring tool and to record the usage events. All of our processes are performed outside Matomo.
The other question is, do they use a specific blacklist? I will not want to our local statistics to show drastically different numbers than the entries in OpenAIRE.
Do they use a specific blacklist? You mean Matomo? I hope so, because I mentioned that we are, apart from Matomo, we are using the counter code of practice list of robots in order to exclude non-legitimate traffic.
Okay. We have another question from Magdalena. If we provide our statistics now and later decide that we no longer want to participate, is there an option to withdraw the data?
Yes, of course. Yes, yes, you could ask and withdraw the data.
Okay. Yes, so we have here a big question from T. Romis. How do metrics like this differentiate between popularity and impact importance? And this is related with, for example, the papers regarding COVID-19 that receive a lot of popularity.
So you mean that we can how do metrics like this differentiate between, so somehow we have to count the topics that are included in this articles are about. I mean, this is how it can be differentiated. This is a part of, I think it's of the monitor that we, the set of indicators that we are producing. So I think it will be, if we include metadata information from OpenAIRE Research Graph, this could be feasible. And we can differentiate this kind of concepts.
I hope
I have answered your question.
He's also asking if we are going to monitor also keyword search to determine search intent and how the paper content satisfies the needs of the person who searches for certain information.
Going to monitor all keyword search. Not for now, we are only counting events as views and downloads. We do not search any other kind of information, but yes, in the future we are planning to include the keyword search.
And we have a question from Oliver. I have noticed for our user statistics that counts for of 2020 have been changed retrospectively. I have collected them about 2 months ago, and when I looked into the dashboard today again, all the accounts from 2020 and 2021 were higher than before. How can that happen?
Okay, can you send me a message, an email, so I can check and I can reply to you?
Yes, sure. I will send you an email.
Sorry, Oliver. I will check it. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for the questions. We also have Maria that raises the hand. Please, Maria, you can open your microphone.
Thank you. Thank you, Dimitris. It was a very interesting and informative talk. My question is about what is the situation with the usage coming from the publisher side? Because they have been obviously recording usage for a long time. Do I understand correctly that until they decide to provide their usage data to you, you cannot add them to your service?
Yeah.
Or can you still sort of take what is published on their platforms and sort of import it anyway?
This is an interesting question. Well, if they are available in public, and they are following some kind of directives, for example, the counter code of practice in particular report, then we can potentially collect them. But you mean without somehow signing a kind of an MOU
agreement.
Or agreement? Yeah. Yeah. I'm not sure we will be able to do it.
Right.
It's a business decision, and we have to discuss it with.
Right, because obviously everything, this would
everything,
be...
Sorry, everything that is available in any form of counter reports can be collected by our service.
Mm. Yeah, it would be incredibly powerful if this service was able to really, unite all usage figures
yes.
from everywhere.
Yes.
Do you know at this moment how the publishers are viewing it, whether they're, inclined to provide their usage data or not?
No, I don't have such an impression, but we are trying to contact as more publishers as possible make agreements with them so that we could collect them because the software is there. I mean, the tracking software is available. So the only thing that is missing is more or less is the participation agreement, etc. So that's where we are trying to contact the publishers and ask them, okay, do you have your statistics? We can collect them. And we can be aggregated, which is an important aspect and powerful aspect of our service. We can aggregate them and you can take them back easily using this counter standards. So I think it's yes, I agree. It's a matter of an agreement with the publishers, and this will make our service more powerful.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for all your questions. I will now share my screen, and it will be quick in order to finish our session. We just have some questions to you about the uses of service, their knowledge, and we would like to have your feedback. That will be important for us in order to develop the future developments. So the first question is, have you activated UsageCounts service? Majority no. We have 4 answers for no and 5 for yes. We are gathering more answers. and the majority didn't activate as user scan service. So today with Dimitri's presentation, we know you know now we how to activate the service. You can access provide dashboard if you have a data source. You can register data source in provide, and then you can also enable the service.
Andre, maybe we could ask our audience if they have already participating, they have registering the provide portal.
Yes, in some cases we have users that already have their data source registered and provide, but not the user scans enabled. So please, if some of you already have enabled the service, the user scan service, but you not ended the configuration in your side, and if you need help, you can also contact us and you can support you in order to conclude this process. Okay. So you already have also the Dimitri's email address in the chat if you need to ask some questions about or not to activate the service. So let's proceed to the next question. Are you using counter release for reports or graphs in OpenAIRE portals? The graphs that Dimitri is also demonstrated today. Okay, some of you are not aware of these reports. And some also are using and finds that are useful, okay. Some are not using, or they found that they are not useful. Okay. So for those that are not aware of these reports, we hope that you are convinced about their potential, and hopefully you in the future you will start using them. Okay. And it's also important for us in order to better disseminate the service, you know, for more people to know this service. Okay, let's move to the upcoming question. Are counter code of practice release 5 new metrics useful? So these new metrics that Dimitris presented today. Okay, majority says yes.
That's very interesting.
Some of you need to learn more about, yes, mm-hmm. Of course. But it's very relevant that you see you find that these reports will be relevant for you. Okay, thank you. Let's move to the upcoming question. Would you like to maintain both release 4 and release 5 graphs and reports in the OpenAIRE provide dashboard?
So not only in provide, but in all maybe mm-hmm. interfaces, yeah.
And we can maintain both releases in the portals, at least for some time, in order to give you the opportunity to move from one kind of report metrics to another, to the most updated, and then we can discontinue. So in the year, your feedback is relevant for us because we will decide according to your preference. We have the participants more or less divided, but we have more people saying yes. Okay. Thank you. We have more questions. Let's move to another. Are more detailed reports, not master reports, useful? So are more detailed reports useful? Yes or no? Okay. 7, 7, 8, 9 people says yes, and more people say that need to learn more about these detailed reports. Okay. Thank you. So, next question. When accessing the reports, would you like to see a preview of the first 20, 30 registries, for example, and then an option to download the full report?
May I jump in and explain somehow what this means? We found that when the report is very large, we are having issues with the performance. So what we have examined is to have the report instead of being in a tabular form or the whole report, to somehow compress it and make it available to the requester, the one who has requested the report in a zip file. So instead of having the report displayed in the OpenAIRE provide, for example, a link with a download of the report will be available. So this is the question: if you would like to see a preview of the of this report, and then an option to you have also the option to download the full report. So there are two options: either we have a preview and the download the full report, or you simply have the option to download the full report and not having a preview. So this is the question. So it looks like it will be useful to have the first 20, 30 register entries. Okay, we are recording that.
Okay, thank you for your feedback. Let's move to the upcoming question. Would you like to have access to more detailed graphics in the provide dashboard, such as the downloads per publication over time and by open access routes? So the impact graphics that Dimitris showed in the monitor portal.
Yeah.
Okay, it seems the participants would like to have them.
We have to change a lot.
Yes. Okay, and also the possibility to select which graphics to showcase in dashboard. It's also relevant. Okay. Okay. Okay, thank you for your feedback. And we have one last question, I think. Do you find useful the number of views and downloads displayed in the data sort page in Explore? For example, the Umiño repository example that Dimitris showed in the demonstration. Okay, participants.
I was expecting the last answer. I mean, they should only be displayed and provided because they are somehow these numbers show the performance of the repository. And so maybe some repositories want to keep them somehow all for their eyes only, all this information.
Okay. And it's also important to improve the way we are presenting the numbers in the portal. We have 6 participants saying that. Okay, let me check if we have another question. No. Great. Many thanks for your feedback. Let's see if we have some additional question in the chat. No, we don't have. Okay. I don't know, Dimitris, if you want to say some words.
No, I just want to thank you for participating. I hope you find useful our service. And I'm waiting for registering for the service and supporting you for deploying and see some your numbers in our service.
Okay. Many thanks, Dimitris.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Andre.
For this webinar. I think it was